Cool. Well, I'm good whenever you
get on set.
Hey, man, this is Kevin Smith, Silent Bob from all those terrible Jay and Silent Bob type pictures, and you're listening to the Eclectica Cafe.
This is Chance, Eclectica Cafe, and I'm sitting down with Dave Clarke and Mark Longenecker. We're at the Gulf Coast Due South Tattoo Expo in Biloxi, Mississippi. Mark and Dave were both contestants on
Ink Master,
yeah. Right? And you were season five, right? Season six?
Yeah, I was five. He was five, I was six.
Okay, cool. And so you guys didn't compete against each other or anything, so, but you run into each other occasionally at conventions, stuff like this?
Oh, yeah, this whole convention circuit, we always see each other.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, once you've been on the show, you're all part of the family now. It's like, only we know the retarded bullshit we went through, so.
Right, yeah.
So we're all family after that.
Cool. So, could you speak to that a little bit about being on Ink Master? What was that experience like? You know, how did it help your guys' career? Did it get, you know, give you some recognition that helped out?
Sure. Or? I always say it was the worst and most stressful thing I've ever been through, like actually being on it, and then after it pays off with everything, with the recognition and people knowing you but being there, I was probably, when I watch myself, I see the most stressed out version of myself I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And people are like, oh, you look so chill. I'm like, well, yeah. I'm actually more chill than that when I'm not freaking out about time constraints and everything that they're doing mentally to make you,
you know, crack or break.
Yeah, the idea, the good TV is if you don't do good, you know?
Right.
If everyone does awesome tattoos, it's not going to have the drive. It's not
Yeah, and that's...
I dropped 120 pounds.
Oh, shit. You're already like...
No, I'm 170 now, but, you know, to be 120 pounds because of the stress from the show, you know, most of almost, I'd have to say... What, 80% of the artists that go on actually were well-known artists that have shining careers before the show.
Yeah.
And I just see the show as a big-ass fucking commercial that keeps re-airing
time
internationally. I mean, we'll see a spike in our social media, and like, it'll be like from Brazil, and you look down and now it's airing in Brazil and shit.
So. Yeah, right. Well, and I mean, I could see how it could be stressful because it could almost like make or break you. It'd be almost like a hard... medium in between there where it's like, well, people are going to see you really fuck up, or they're going to see you do extraordinary.
I tell people this, if you go online and you look up every Ink Master artist that's been on the show and you look at the work that they've done off the show and you look at the work they did on the show, none of us did anything remotely too capable of what we are actually capable of.
Yeah, because it pushed your limits. Yeah.
No, they didn't even push our limits.
But you pushed yourself.
They set you up for failure.
Right,
you
know? Yeah.
They want you to fail.
It causes you to push yourself that much further. But yeah, I mean, I can see what you're saying about them almost banking on you fucking up, because I don't think what a lot of people understand about reality TV is, like you said, if everything is just kind of like, you know, regular day throughout the course of this filming, there's nothing exciting about that. So something always has to happen, some sort of, you know, shenanigans or something has to come up.
That's the format.
Yeah.
You know, it was like Miami Ink and New York Ink and all those days, for those shows, it was the opposite. They would never like try to make their tattoo look bad, you know?
Sure.
Well, I mean, I always tell people, let's look at the prior TV shows before Ink Masters. You know, Miami Ink, for instance, its ratings skyrocketed when Kat Von D was on there and she was arguing at Omni and stuff all
right,
the time.
Right.
Soon as she left, Miami Ink's ratings fucking tanked.
Right. Well, she's not bad to look at either.
But their show tanked. Then she started her show, and the ratings were off the roof because there was a bunch of girls fighting in a shop with a bunch of other
artists.
Right,
just a bunch of drama.
And as soon as she got rid of the drama out of her shop, her show tanked.
Right.
Yeah,
America loves train wrecks.
Sure.
We
sure.
love train
she
wrecks.
She got sober. It's no fun anymore.
Yeah.
Was there some? And I don't know if you guys can speak to this, but did it feel scripted ever? Like, were you guys put in situations where you know, had to?
People ask me that all the time. I always say, I never said anything that I was told to say. You know, I really don't have time. Everything that you're saying during the actual time that you see us has to come out of my mouth. There's no scripts. But there is parts where we're kind of narrating what happened. And they want everyone's story of every single thing that happened.
Yeah,
so they can cut to those narrations from everyone.
And so they can have something substantial.
And they can edit things in any way they want, too. You know, everything happened real, but they can kind of guide how things happen, but they can't control what we say and do, but they can kind of maneuver it.
Sure,
and
sure.
And then they'll edit it. Like, we're mic'd the entire time. Even when they're not filming, they're recording us.
Right, right.
You know, I have examples, and I won't say, but there's times where people's voices were dubbed over in scenes, and you're like, what the fuck? I was there. He didn't say that.
Right, yeah. You know? Wow, that's really weird.
Yeah. That stuff's cut together in different ways.
Yeah.
Like I had Clean crying about his kids to me, and then they cut that to a whole different time when I was calling him an asshole.
Yep.
So I was calling him an asshole, and then they showed him crying.
So it was out of context.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it was completely out of context.
It
was
a week later.
Right. So where are you guys from?
I'm from Cocoa Beach, Florida.
Okay.
I'm from Fort Walton Beach, Destin, Florida.
Okay, so it's not too, this isn't too far of a trek for you guys.
For him, it's a hell of a drive, but for me, it's only 2.5 hours.
Okay. As far as, like, you know, the show is concerned, Ink Masters and tattooing, you know, that's a really good example of how it's really slipped into the mainstream tattoo pop culture within the last 15, maybe even 20 years. And a lot of times people can say that that's almost like a blessing and a curse, and I know, like, your guys' perspective, that's really good for business. It's, you know, that it's become more of a popular thing. But as far as it becoming so mainstream where, you know, there's not the edginess maybe that there used to be with tattooing.
And long gone.
Yeah, yeah. You know, if you saw a guy with a tattoo, you know that he would, you know, be maybe kind of a dangerous guy, or at least he'd be some sort of an interesting character. But, you know, like frat guys, you know, tribal tattoos, and
I think tattooing doctors and lawyers and stuff.
Louis C.K. said something along the lines of, I used to be, you know, if I saw a guy tattoo, I thought he was going to fuck me up. Now I just think he's going to make me a mocha or something. But, I mean, like I said, from a business standpoint, that's good for you guys. But as far as, like, the social aspect of it, how do you guys see that?
I remember, you know, when I learned how to tattoo, it was a very, like, biker thing, and in the biker world, and they only kept it in that world. And it was a violent thing. They always say you have to learn how to fight before you learn how to tattoo. And I got thrown out of a lot of shops. And when I opened my shop years down the road, I wanted to go against all that. I wanted to have the most inviting, open shop, friendly, and just, you know, and these days you have to have that. But then when you look back at that, and then people come in and start talking shit to the tattoo artist, and, like, I remember the days where you were scared to walk in a shop, and the dude kind of start to miss that.
It was intimidating,
the nostalgia of that.
I came in the tail end of that, so I got when I came in the industry, I got the very tail end of the old the old era of the tattoo, where, like, somebody opened up a shop and it was a rival shop, they firebombed it. I got to come in at the very end of that, but unfortunately, I kind of missed that era too. Like Mark was just saying, because people come in now and they think they know more about what should go on their body and how it should be put in their body and what design should go on their body, without any thought that that's what we do for a living. You know, I don't tell a nurse how to put a catheter in me, because that's what she does for a living.
Right, yeah.
You know, the downside of the TV shows and the popularity of tattoos is everybody thinks they're experts at it now.
Absolutely.
Without having any experience.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, have you guys seen, like, with the TV shows, not just your personal businesses, but just the business overall going up in, you know,
people?
Yeah,
the business is getting more packed, and more people are saturating it because more people are getting tattooed and stuff like that. Like you said a minute ago, it's a double-edged sword. There's its pros with it, because there's a lot more business being done now, and you're getting to do a lot more tattoos, but there's cons to it, too.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
I think, you know, Mike Ness from Social Distortion, I read a quote from him a long time ago. It said something like, I miss the individuality. If you want to do something different, don't get a tattoo nowadays.
Which, and that's a big push for me. I was talking with Mark's buddy yesterday about, you could tell a successful artist from an average run-of-the-mill artist. And you know what separates a successful artist from a run-of-the-mill artist? It's not the work. It's not the tattoos. It's the morals. Mm-hmm. Are you willing to do this to make a quick $50, or are you willing to tell that
right
because you know it's morally wrong?
Yeah, right. Well, and I noticed that the past year or so. About a year ago, I got a tattoo from a street shop in Las Vegas. It was in Planet Hollywood. It was an awesome shop, and it was beautiful inside and everything. But about, I don't know, 5 or 6 months after that, I got a tattoo from a guy that just runs it out of his own little studio space. He's not in an actual shop. He just had, it's like kind of an attachment off of his garage almost. And like, I could tell really the difference of, I didn't really feel rushed at that shop in Las Vegas, but I didn't necessarily feel like we were taking our time either. Whereas the guy that had the shop in his house was like, you know, I'm only going to do it for a couple hours because I don't want to get you in and out of here. I don't want to rush us. I want this to be really good. And I could really tell that difference in quality over quantity.
Well, if he had a shop that was professionally licensed in a separate building or building, that's cool. But if it's any other shit, that's like...
sketch.
Yeah, kitchen magician? Kitchen magician?
Yeah, kitchen magician, exactly. You know, like my client the other day, I had a great client. I'm sitting there tattooing, and this woman's in my shop telling me how she paid $15 for her son's tattoo. And I'm like, $15?
Right.
Where'd you get this tattoo? And she said, out of a house. And my client goes, well, let's say you're best friends with a dentist and you got a toothache. Mm-hmm. Do you go to your best friend's house or do you go to his place of business?
Sure. Yeah.
For your toothache.
Yeah, and I think that that's something that people... Like they're always like trying to look for the best monetary deal on a tattoo, and it's like, but you're gonna want to spend some money on something, you know.
I always tell people this: you got an iPhone brand new is what, $600-$700. It lasts you a year or two, and then you throw it away and you have to get a new one. But a tattoo is on your body for the rest of your damn life.
Yeah.
And you want to go half ass on a tattoo for something the rest of your life? That makes no fucking sense.
Totally. Yeah.
Hey, going back to what you're saying about rushing tattoos and. I personally book one tattoo a day, and that's what, actually, I was doing two tattoos a day for a long time. It was pretty stressful. I would do a noon and a 5 o'clock, and of course I've never done my noon by the time the 5 o'clock's there, and then they're pacing around in the lobby.
And you're burned out. And
well, I'm not burned out, but it's like, I only want that person to know that they're having my full concentration.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
They know when the other person's there that now I'm thinking about that tattoo.
Absolutely.
That's how it is at my shop. One person a day. That's all I work on.
Yeah.
Because you deserve that respect. I mean, you live with this forever. I tell people tattoos, it's a mutual bond for the rest of our lives.
Mm-hmm.
You permanently wear my work. You live with my work for the rest of your life. My name will always be attached to your tattoo. So if I fuck it up or I didn't give it the love that it deserves.
Yeah, that's your reputation.
That's a bad reflection of me, and I cannot stand that. Mark
right.
cannot stand that.
Absolutely.
You know, that's why we do it this way. We care about what we do. That's what goes back to what I was saying about morals. You got the guy that wants to make a quick $50, and then you got guys like us that think about the long game, you know?
Absolutely.
So I lose a little bit of money on this tattoo. Okay, oh well, I care about what the work was.
Mm-hmm.
And in the end, I make more money because I stay busier.
Sure. Well, and we've talked...
I want a good photo of it.
Yep.
Yeah, and we've talked to... on our podcast quite a bit about the idea now of tattoos not even being socially acceptable, but now more acceptable in the workplace. And I'm in the Air Force, and recently there was a lift on the ban on tattoos.
Oh, yeah.
Where
I'm in an Air Force town, I know.
Oh, yeah. I mean, like before it was, I think it was like your exposed body part couldn't be more than a fourth tattooed or something. And nothing above the collar, which I still don't think it's above the collar, but like I think now you can get sleeved up to your wrist.
And you're allowed to have one ring finger tattoo.
Okay.
In the Air Force too.
All right. Yeah. So I mean, so that's good news for me. So, and that's one of the reasons I'm here. I'm getting tattooed today, even. And what do you guys think about professionalism and
all that stuff's going to change because all the tattoo people are going to be in the people making the decisions and people of power.
Mm-hmm.
So everyone's tattooed now. And everyone's rising into those positions and making the decisions, and they understand that the tattoos doesn't change the way you work.
So it's a generational thing.
I think,
Yeah.
I compare it to a can of Pringles. Once you pop that lid of Pringles and you get that first chip, I'm only going to get two or three, you end up eating half the can.
Oh, yeah.
Well, as soon as you get your first tattoo, that seal's been broken. You realize you didn't change as a person. You're still just as good of a person as you were before
Absolutely.
The tattoo.
Absolutely.
So once that seal's been broken, it's game on. You can keep getting tattooed mm-hmm. after that. You realize that your tattoo doesn't define you as a person.
Right.
Your actions define you. So people are starting to realize just because you have tattoos, your actions don't define you. I'm covered in tattoos, and the worst thing on my record is a speeding ticket.
Mm-hmm.
One.
So, I mean, and that kind of speaks to stereotyping is... There was always a stereotype, like we were talking about before, of guys who had tattoos were hell's angels, hookers, you know, prisoners. They've probably been through some shit before. But now there is definitely a change in the culture where it's more socially acceptable, so just about everybody's doing it. So I personally see it as like a somewhat offensive that people are so quick to stereotype. But I do see that as sort of, like you said, generationally, that generation is getting out of the workforce, they're retiring.
You have to be a stupid boss to think, I'll take the person who doesn't work, has work, less work ethics, because he has less tattoos, the show, over mm-hmm. the guy that I know is a great hard worker, but he's covered in tattoos. So
exactly.
I can't have him.
Yeah.
Like, how stupid do you have to be to think that way?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
People are wising up and understanding, like, tattoos have nothing to do with your work ethic and how good you are at performance as a worker.
Yeah. Well, and the Air Force took a page out of the Navy's book, because the Navy said a long time ago, I mean, and people know the Navy, tattooed sailors, it's always been associated with tattoos. And, you know, they said a long time ago, why are we going to deny talent just based off of a tattoo or some sort of body
art? My time in the Army, I was full sleeved. When I was in the Army, I had full sleeves. You know, I was heavily covered in tattoos. We were trained to kill.
Right, right.
That was our job.
It didn't have anything to do with...
And I'll be honest with you, my time, I was OIF-1. I was the invasion year of Iraq. And I'm sitting there on convoy operations, and we'd have to pull over and do something, and they'd see my tattoos. The Iraqi kids would see my tattoos, and they'd stay the hell away from me.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? That just meant I was a little bit safer.
Yeah.
I was a little bit safer at that point, before that point.
So it paid off for you at that time, the stereotyping. Yeah.
But, you know, the rest of the world here in the U.S., you know, even in Europe, I just got back from Germany. They're starting to be way more accepting of it, and people are starting to realize just because you have the ink doesn't make you a different
person. Yeah, I could see. I mean, and you guys obviously know more about this than me, but I could see Europe being far ahead of where
we
are.
Actually, they're far behind.
Really?
They have some of the best artists out there, some of the best tattoo artists, but they're actually really far behind. My grandparents, for instance, most Germans, because I'm German, don't...
No, me too.
It's very taboo. You know, they're very, very...
traditional.
Very conservative people
over there. Okay.
And finally, my grandmother, a few years back, got a tattoo from me. Hardest tattoo I ever did was tattooing my grandmother.
I bet.
But they're starting to open their eyes, but it's still more taboo over there than it is here.
Sure. Okay. So, I mean, and I'm thinking of, like, France, you know, these big metropolitan areas.
Oh,
more.
Yeah. That's cool there, but overall, Europe, it's...
Okay.
Yeah, it's still pretty different.
Well, the old joke for, like, they would call the hand tattoos the job stopper.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a whole total different definition of it. I call it the asshole filter. Because then if you get a hand tattoo, you'll never be able to work for an asshole again. So you can only work for cool people. So I'm sorry.
That's cool.
I'm sorry that I made you only be able to work for cool
people. Yeah. Well, and I thought of it this way one time. I'm like, you know, I for a long time wouldn't entertain the idea of getting something that was like below the sleeve, and I was like, do I really want to work somewhere though that's going to be that uptight? Yeah. And do I want to work for people like that? And I felt like this is going to keep me honest with myself necessarily, you know, more than anything.
And I have a slightly different view than his, and I have nothing against hand and finger tattoos. My problem is I make my clients have a certain requirement and coverage first, because right now there are people that will judge you and stuff and hinder you. And I tell people there is a chance that you, because of your tattoo on your hands, you could lose an opportunity of making $80,000, $100,000 a year.
Yeah.
You know? Think about how many CEOs of Fortune 500 companies have tattoos on their hands.
A chunk of them might have tattoos
somewhere else on their body that they can hide. But until the next, you know, in 10 years, that will probably be different. And great, I'll gladly adapt then.
Yeah.
But right now, I still got to think about karma. You know,
yeah.
I want to think about karma of my clients. It would kill me to, you know, I get an 18-year-old walk in my shop all the time, and they're like, yeah, I want this across my neck or this across my hand, and they have no tattoos anywhere else.
It's hard to have to educate
them.
Yeah.
So I just set a rule at my shop that it's no across the board unless you meet a certain threshold in ink.
That makes a lot of sense. Yeah. That's a really good standard to look at.
Yeah.
And I guess that goes back to what you said before about morally looking at, you know, not just trying to make a quick buck on somebody. And
like one of the funniest things was in Hartford, Connecticut, I had a mom show up going, I want an infinity knot with my kids' names. And I was like, you're going to hate what I say, but if you let me finish, you're going to fine now, I'm trying to help you.
Right.
I was like, do you care so little about your kids that you're going to copy what every single other mother does? Is that how little your kids mean to you? No, your kids mean more than that. So let's figure out how to make it more mean more
sure.
than that.
Sure, yeah, because it's
and
so cliche.
What morals,
and,
yeah. You know, that's absolutely. What I think is morals. If an artist says, yeah, I'll put your kids' names in an infinity not this big and knowing it's going to be a blob in 10 years.
Right.
There's more shitbags in the industry that do that.
Well, that kind of brings me to one of the last things I want to talk to you guys about, and you had mentioned this, was how you represent maybe who you're working for. And, you know, you said there's not a lot of CEOs that have tattoos on their hands. And where do you think that is relevant as far as 8 hours a day, this person is basically leasing me for their services. So should I present myself in a certain way that they want to be their company to be represented?
To me, my look at it this way. If you can wear a long sleeve shirt and still look professional, great. Mm-hmm. You know, in 10 years time, you know, if people got tattoos in their hands and faces and work it, that's awesome. Great, I have nothing against it. I can't be a hypocrite because I got shit on my hands and neck, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm all for change and adapting and not judging a book by its cover. But unfortunately, there's still a small percentage that does.
Sure.
So I got to keep that in mind when I think about my clients. I hope to God in, you know, 10 years, 15 years that nobody cares and judges people by their tattoos. I would love to see that. I mean, I don't think a single tattoo artist in this whole fucking industry would, you know, not want to see that. You know, we don't want people judged for the ink on their body. We want them judged for the content of their character mm-hmm. and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So when it comes to businesses, I can understand as a business owner going, hey, yeah, you know, but I also can understand at the same time that, you know, your right to be who you are is your right to be who you are.
Right. Yeah, that's a fine line, definitely. Yeah.
As far as that whole thing of saying, well, I'm a, when people say I'm a professional, so I can't show tattoos, I take it as an insult, you know? I'm just like, well, what am I? You don't think I'm a professional? You know, and what about all these other people that are covered in tattoos that are making a living? You know, that's like the tattooed and employed. Like, I'm proud of who I am.
Yeah, totally.
And I think if you know you're going to go down the road of corporate and that's what you want to be, which I've always been against, then that's what you want to do.
That's the path you choose.
And I can educate you and say that in the beginning and say, if you think you want to be in the corporate world, then don't do these tattoos. Because they're going to get against you.
Yeah.
But I can set you on a path that'll make sure that you don't go in there. And you'll have to make money a different way. You'll have to be creative. You have to be either an artist or a musician or all these other things and outlets mm-hmm. for ways to make money. And there is. And there's plenty of other ways that you don't have to be a corporate person, you know?
Sure, absolutely.
I mean, hell, a good example. I mean, I'm a tattoo artist. Art's been my passion, but I was a helicopter crew chief. I fixed and flew in helicopters. I can literally go to any company right now and probably be a fucking aircraft mechanic, make $20+ an hour, you know, easily, but no fucking problem working in that world. So yeah, there's always options and stuff, but like I said, there's a fine line too, you know, like there are people that are still judgmental. There's a fine line because like there are jobs, let's say you're a restaurant owner and stuff like that, and your waiters are covered in tattoos and stuff. Well, there's probably a quarter of your little surrounding area people that probably would go, oh, these people are just covered in that shit, and then we'll never do business with you. So, yeah, you don't want those people in your
people
business.
Then there's people like me that will support it.
Yeah,
absolutely.
If I go to a heavily restaurant that everyone's heavily tattooed, then I'll tip more. I'll appreciate the people that run that business more.
Well, Starbucks, it was like 2 years ago, they did away with their ban. I don't know if you remember this, but like you'd go in there and you'd see the baristas, they would wear like compression sleeves because they were covering their tattoos.
I wish Hooters would go away their ban. Because you don't have any ridiculous. Hot young
do they not have a? Do they have a tattoo ban?
They have a tattoo
shit, really?
Ban. No visible tattoo.
Hooters is so stuck in the 80s.
Because
it'll never
that's true. They got the bangs and
everything. I would love to see Hooters girls covered in tattoos.
Oh, hell yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, that doesn't really add up at all. But that's weird. I guess I could see like, you know, you look who goes there, it's like a bunch of, you know, pasty old white guys. You know, they're probably still like, they like to see some big titties, but they don't want to.
So, you know, you got a business owner who's thinking financially about money. Then you got people like us that are like, oh, well, I have the right to be who I am. So it is a double-edged sword. Yeah. You know, because this person that owns a company has to think about how do they make business better? How do they make more money for themselves? Because that's what all everybody... We don't go into business for ourselves to be like, well, I just want to barely skate by. We want to make as much money so we, the older we get, the easier we can live our lives.
Absolutely.
And so it's a double-edged sword. I personally would love to have everybody tattooed and have nobody being judged. But unfortunately, I live in a real world where people are still assholes and judge people. So
the last thing that I have for you guys is... What would you want to tell somebody who wants to get a tattoo? Like, what's the easiest way to deal with a potential client? Like, what's your tips for these people? And you guys mentioned, you know, you don't be a know-it-all. That's one thing.
I'll let him answer his version, and I'll give you mine.
All right.
So a beginner walks in and is getting their first tattoo?
Anybody. Like, you know, we talked about people that think they know it all, so they're going to tell you guys.
Well,
but
I always say in this day and age, if you get a bad tattoo, shame on you. You know, back in the day, it was different. There's just so much out there. There's all the social media. There's no way that you can't do your research on an artist and not know what you're going to get. So if you say, I walked in the shop and I got this and I can't believe I did that, then you're an idiot. You know, like, everyone's doing Yelp reviews, Google reviews. Everyone's looking on Instagram, looking at the work. You find somebody that you like based on what their lifestyle is, like, I attract the people that like the same things that I like. I tattoo fishermen, I tattoo surfers, I tattoo divers, I tattoo people that love the beach and tropical stuff, mm-hmm. reggae, and those are, like, everything that I put out there attracts the same kind of people, and those are the people that I tattoo.
Awesome, that's cool.
And I think if you look for that same kind of person that you are in your artist, then you'll get a good tattoo.
Great.
I tell people there's two types of clients out there. You have people that research and find the artist whose overall body of work speaks to them, fits them, and then you have those that pick their designs, okay? And I've learned one thing, people that pick their designs, like go online looking for designs that they want to wear that's on somebody else's body, mm-hmm. those people are always unhappy in the long run.
That makes sense, yeah.
Getting cover-ups.
Yeah, and the people that pick their artist, because of the overall body of their work, are happy for life because they did their research. I don't want my clients to come in with a set idea. I want them to come in with a broad idea.
Sure, saying, an open mind.
You know, open mind, and you pick me because you like my work, and you say, hey, this is what I want. Like, my guy yesterday blatantly said he wanted an angel to be an angel, Asian, and coming from darkness somehow. He liked my work, and he just said, do what you do.
Yeah, he trusts you.
He's already comfortable from looking at your stuff, and he knew that you could handle his idea.
Exactly. And so I gave him what he wanted, but my rendition, because he picked me for the artist I already am, not because of what he was, one picture he liked.
Absolutely.
He liked the overall work.
Absolutely.
Mark is picked, people pick him because of his cool, unique, when you see a Mark Longenecker tattoo, you know it's a Mark Longenecker tattoo. There is no questions asked about it. And so he stays busy because those people picked him for his work, not because of one tattoo he did, but the overall feel.
Sure.
Those people are happier longer compared to, I found this on Pinterest and I wear it, and in 10 years that trend is no longer popular and it's actually made fun of. People don't think about that.
Sure.
You know, like birds of a feather, for instance. Mm-hmm. There's not a tattoo artist that's professional and has morals that likes birds of a feather tattoo, because there's a trillion young ladies out there wearing it.
Yeah.
And they wouldn't wear the same prom dress as another girl for one damn night, but they're willing to wear a tattoo for the rest of their life as somebody else that is now starting to be made fun of.
Right.
You see where I'm going?
Yeah.
If you picked your artist based off the overall feel of their work and just how they do things, and then you let them design your tattoo, you're happy for life with your tattoo.
Cool. All right, well, where can we find you guys? Online, social media?
You can find me on Instagram at Dave Handlebar Clark. You can also Dave the Tat Guy on Facebook, Dave Clark Stash on Twitter, and I'm from Long Beach, Destin, Florida, and I'm always traveling, so.
Cool.
And just look up Mark Longenecker. There's a little trick. E in the name.
Yeah, I screwed that up last night.
So Longenecker, or actually if you said it like it was spelled, it'd be like Longenecker.
Longenecker. Cool.
That's German.
All right.
I always tell people Dave Clarke tattoo, you know, and make sure you add that E at the end of Clark.
Cool. All right. Well, Mark. All right. It's a pleasure, guys. Dave.
It's a pleasure.
All right, man. Well, good luck, you guys.